Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the culmination of one incredible summer. A night where babyfaces and the hometown hero get booed, where the legend and the WWE champion get the wave, only one protagonist wins, and we crown the new youngest world champion in company history just to be petty assholes. Just before 2019 Summer Classic in Toronto happens, time to talk about the last time this show took place in Toronto. My name is James, you're tuning in to episode 67 of From the Vault, and this is From the Vault, SummerSlam 2004. Take us in, Alicia.
Hey guys, this is the interview queen, Alicia Atu, and you are currently watching We Are Pro Wrestling, home of From the Vault. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and hit that ding notification bell so anytime they post a brand new video, you'll get an alert and you can check it out. You guys, what are you waiting for? Go check it out, check out their archive, subscribe so you get all of those new videos. Dive in.
WWE SummerSlam 2004 from August 15th, 2004 at the Air Canada Centre in Toronto, Ontario, Canada, the host of SummerSlam 2019. Granted, the building's not the same name, but the building is the same building. The attendance for SummerSlam 2004 was 17,640, up from 16,113 from SummerSlam 2003. The only difference is 2003's edition was sold out. The live gate for SummerSlam 2004 was $1 million. I don't know if that was American dollars or Canadian dollars, but still a $1 million live gate is a pretty damn good gate. And that gate was up from the $713,000 live gate from SummerSlam 2003, and the pay-per-view buys for SummerSlam 2004, $320,000, down from $465,000 from SummerSlam 2003. Now, compared to the rest of the WWE pay-per-views in 2004, the attendance was the third highest, WrestleMania 20 the highest, and the pay-per-view buys was the fourth highest, WrestleMania 20 was the highest. Now, SummerSlam 2004 was only the third SummerSlam up to that point that hit the $1 million mark in terms of the live gate. 1992 and 2000 were the other two. And SummerSlam 2004 was also the lowest bought SummerSlam since 1998 and would remain the lowest from that year moving forward until 2011. Now, business-wise, SummerSlam 2004 didn't do that terrible in terms of 2004 numbers, but by no means was it the numbers of a few years prior. Quality of the show-wise? This one's not one of the better SummerSlams ever, although it's one of the more memorable SummerSlams we've ever seen. Maybe not for all the right reasons, but memorable nonetheless. Your commentators for the night were, for Raw, Jim Ross and Jerry the King Lawler, and for SmackDown, Michael Cole and Taz. Your Sunday Night Heat match saw Rob Van Dam defeat Rene Dupree in 6 minutes 7 seconds. Now, the opening match for SummerSlam 2004 was a 6-man tag team match, the Dudley Boys versus Rey Mysterio, Paul London, and Billy Kidman. Spike Dudley was the WWE Cruiserweight Champion, London and Kidman were the WWE Tag Team Champions. Now, London and Kidman beat Bubba and Devon for the Tag Team Championships in early July, around the same time Bubba and Devon started helping Spike win matches, leading to Spike beating Rey Mysterio for the Cruiserweight Championship at the end of July, which led to Spike's heel turn in early August, adopting the character of The Boss. Now, the 6-man tag team match to open up SummerSlam 2004, it was a solid opening 6-man tag team match. It's not one of the best matches in the world, but it was a solid opener to the show. And really, when you look at this card, it's one of the better matches on this show. I do wish, however, that they would have separated the championships, because if you look at this show, weren't many championship matches. I mean, hell, the Raw Tag Team Champions at that point weren't even on this show. There was, Well, I'll talk about the United States Championship later on. The Women's Championship wasn't on this show. Really, you had the two world titles, the Intercontinental Championship, and that was it. You could have separated the champions. You could have done two championship matches on this show, take some time from the other matches, and give us two good title matches. You could have had Rey Mysterio and Spike Dudley open the show for the Cruiserweight Championship, then have the Dudley Boys versus London and Kidman for the Tag Team Championships a few matches later. Now, I didn't hate the six-man tag team match. It was solid for what it was, but I kind of wish they would have added a little more championships to this show because, again, outside of the two world titles and the Intercontinental Championship, there wasn't much in terms of championship matches on this show. Now, in this match, the Dudley Boys defeated Rey Mysterio, Paul London, and Billy Kidman in 8 minutes 6 seconds. Next up was the Till Death Do Us Part match, Kane versus Matt Hardy, with the winner earning the right to marry Lita. This entire angle, which started off with Kane and Matt Hardy, which eventually went to Kane and Snitsky, which went to Kane and Edge, and then Edge and Matt Hardy, this whole fucking thing I could do an entire From the Vault on, but that's another story for another time. Now, Kane and Matt Hardy, heading into this show. This was the culmination of a four-month feud between the two. It started in April when Matt saved Lita from Kane, leading to attacks and then kidnapping, sextortion, pregnancy, proposal, more fighting. It's this portion of the entire giant landscape. This is one of the most soap opera-y angles in WWE history. It was later revealed that Kane was the father of Lita's unborn child. Lita accepted a stipulation that whoever won at SummerSlam between Kane and Matt Hardy, she would marry the winner. Now, for a feud that had been going on since April, one of the longer lasting feuds heading into the show, you would think Kane versus Matt Hardy Till Death Do Us Part match, that this would be a little higher on the card, but no, it's only the second match in. Also, this is a bit of backwards in booking, and you would think that this match for the right to marry Lita would be a fight to the death. One fighting for the woman he loved, the other fighting for the woman who's carrying his baby. You would think fight to the death. But instead, this match had just regular rules. They did have a match before this, but their first match was a match with no rules. Kind of backwards. It should have been opposite. Their match at Vengeance should have been just the regular one-on-one match. This match here should have been the no rules, fight to the death, winner marries Lita. Now, regardless of all that, the match here was... the match was not terrible. I'm not gonna say it was good because it wasn't really that good at all. But just overall, it wasn't terrible. It was just meh. I mean, I should note that Matt entered this match with a serious knee injury, surgery required after the show. But outside of that, it's just... this match was not terrible. It was not good. It was just... like a lot of things on this show, just really meh. Kane defeated Matt Hardy in 6 minutes 8 seconds. Leading to the wedding of Kane and Lita, leading to all the stuff with Snitsky and then Edge and then Matt Hardy comes back and just this whole thing. Again, the whole thing starting with Kane and Matt Hardy, leading to Kane and Snitsky, Kane and Edge, then Edge and Matt Hardy, and all this, you know, this stuff that's a work that eventually becomes shoot stuff. Like, this entire thing, I could do an entire From the Vault on. But that's another story for another time. After that, the first match in a best of five series for the WWE United States Championship. WWE United States Champion Booker T versus challenger John Cena. Whoever wins, best three out of five, so whoever wins three matches first is the winner and the United States Champion. Now, on the July 8th episode of SmackDown, then-General Manager Kurt Angle stripped John Cena of the United States Championship after Cena accidentally attacked Angle. On the July 29th episode of SmackDown, Booker T won an 8-man elimination match to win the vacant United States Championship. New general manager Theodore Long made a best-of-five series for the championship between Booker and Cena, match one to take place at SummerSlam. Now, Cena got a huge ovation during his entrance, but after the three count, it was just a nice pop, because, yeah, this match was not that good. It's not the worst thing on this night, I'll get to that, but this match is really nothing you'd go back and watch over and over again. I mean, this was a couple years later, maybe this would have been better, but here in 2004, Cena was still a little bit green. He was not big match John just yet. So the match, not good, but not the worst thing on the night. John Cena defeated Booker T in 6 minutes, 25 seconds. And that's another thing, it was only given like 6.5 minutes. But Cena defeated Booker. Cena would end up winning the best of five to win back the United States Championship in match number 5. Now after that was the first real championship match of SummerSlam 2004. A triple threat match for the WWE Intercontinental Championship. You had Champion Edge versus challengers Chris Jericho and Batista. Edge is currently in reign number 5 with the Intercontinental Championship, winning it at Vengeance the month prior. Now, as far as the match itself goes, the match was okay. It was far from a great match, but not one of the worst either. In terms of Intercontinental Championship matches in SummerSlam history, it's not a top tier, it's not a bottom tier, it's just right there in the middle. It was okay for what it was. However, the match itself is not why this match is memorable. Because this match, the triple threat for the Intercontinental Championship, is most famous for the hometown hero Edge getting booed big time. Toronto booed the shit out of him. This was one of the many times on this night that faces got booed. Jericho got a good reaction at least, but yeah. Edge, it was around this time that Edge was starting to get negative reactions from the crowd, because when he returned in the spring of 2004, Edge was stale as a babyface, and you know, he was really the same character from when he left at the, you know, beginning of 2003. He was pretty much the same character, and when your hometown boos you and you're a babyface, yeah, you're fucking stale as a babyface. So this was really the beginning of Edge's heel turn, which led to Edge's great heel run. But yeah, that's what this match is famous for. Edge getting booed in his hometown. And the match itself, okay for what it was. Not great, not terrible, just okay. Edge defeated Chris Jericho and Batista in 8 minutes, 26 seconds to retain the Intercontinental Championship, only the third time in SummerSlam history up to that point that the Intercontinental Champion retained the belt, only the second man to ever do so. Shawn Michaels did it twice prior, but this was the first time that somebody retained the Intercontinental Championship at SummerSlam by pinfall, because Shawn retained via countout and via a ladder match. So there's a little bit of history for you. Now, following that was SmackDown's big grudge match of the night. It was a return match from WrestleMania 20. Kurt Angle versus Eddie Guerrero. Guerrero had defeated Angle at WrestleMania 20 to retain the WWE Championship. Post-WrestleMania, Kurt Angle went into the role of SmackDown General Manager. At the Great American Bash, Guerrero had initially been declared the winner of the Texas Bull Rope match and initially declared having retained the WWE Championship. However, after the replay was shown, John Bradshaw Layfield's shoulder touched the final turnbuckle before Guerrero's hand did. Kurt Angle awarded the match and the championship to JBL. In a steel cage rematch, Kurt Angle, under the El Gran Luchador mask, cost Eddie Guerrero that match. And because of that, and embellishing his injury, because Kurt Angle had been kayfabe in a wheelchair, had a broken leg, Because of that, because of costing Guerrero the cage match, embellishing his injuries, Kurt Angle was fired as SmackDown general manager and put back in as an active competitor. The rematch was set between Kurt Angle and Eddie Guerrero for SummerSlam. Now, after four mediocre to meh matches, we finally got a really good one. In fact, this was one of the only truly good matches on this entire show. Now, I talked about the crowd during the IC title match. They kind of struck again here because they were cheering Kurt Angle over Eddie Guerrero. Kurt Angle was a heel, Eddie Guerrero the babyface, but they chose Angle here, which here many other things prove that no matter what Kurt Angle did around this point, Kurt Angle was Teflon to the fans. I talked about it in my Kurt Angle episode. He said and did so many diabolical, terrible things. It didn't matter what Kurt Angle did. The crowd was going to love him no matter what. But this match, a really good match. Not as good as their WrestleMania match, but still very good. One of the only truly good things on this entire show. Kurt Angle defeated Eddie Guerrero in 13 minutes, 38 seconds. Now next up, after SmackDown's big grudge match, you had Raw's big grudge match. And no, I'm not kidding. This next match was a matchup that actually happened at a Big Four pay-per-view. And I'm not kidding. This was Raw's big grudge match for SummerSlam 2004. And before people out there claim bullshit, context is everything. Heading into this show, this match was arguably Raw's biggest match of the night. Even more so than the World Heavyweight Championship match, because unlike the world title match, this match here actually had some layers of story heading into it. But Raw's big grudge match of SummerSlam 2004, Triple H versus Eugene. And I know that request of, you know, you guys claiming bullshit, and most of you are probably laughing when hearing Triple H Eugene big grudge match. But again, context is everything. This was a big match heading into this show. Maybe that kind of paints a picture of Raw in 2004, but hey, it's better than Raw in 2019, so there's that. I digress, though. The character of Eugene was introduced to the Raw roster in the spring of 2004. In the summer, trying to get back the World Heavyweight Championship, Triple H, he decided that he was going to use Eugene in order to get his belt back. After failing to win back the World Heavyweight Championship at Vengeance, Triple H and Evolution absolutely destroyed Eugene, to which Eugene cost Triple H the Iron Man match against Benoit on Raw. It was revealed that William Regal let Eugene in the building to cost Triple H the Iron Man match. Quote, "It was very foolish to take advantage of a disadvantaged boy because now you've made an enemy out of me," leading to Triple H versus Regal, which really wasn't much of a match because Triple H ended up annihilating William Regal, leading to general manager Eric Bischoff giving Triple H a match with Eugene at SummerSlam. Now, I glossed over this match during my Reign of Terror episode. Now, I was right about the crowd turning on Eugene because, like a lot of other babyfaces on this show, Eugene got booed, Eugene sucks chance. This match pretty much signaled the end of Eugene in the upper card on Raw. The crowd turned on him. But going back and watching this match, I kind of poo-pooed the match, but going back and watching this match, this match was actually not that terrible. It's not one of Triple H's, you know, one of his great matches, because it's far from it, but it's not one of Triple H's worst Big Four matches either, and he's had a ton of bad Big Four pay-per-view matches, especially at WrestleMania, but this is SummerSlam where Triple H kind of has a good track record in terms of SummerSlam matches, but Yeah, in terms of big four matches that sticks out like a sore thumb in terms of opponents, this one more than anyone else sticks out because it's Triple H versus Eugene. But the match itself, it was not terrible. It wasn't great, it wasn't bad, it was actually kind of an okay match. Triple H defeated Eugene in 14 minutes 6 seconds, again, signaling the end of Eugene in the upper card on Raw. Now after Raw's big grudge match, you had another thing involving Raw. After that, you had a good old-fashioned game of dodgeball. Divas dodgeball, to be exact. You had the Diva Search girls, Amy Weber, Christy Hemme, Joy Giovanni, Maria Kanellis, Michelle McCool, and Tracy Wright versus the Raw Divas, Gail Kim, Jazz, Molly Holly, Nydia, Stacy Keibler, and Victoria, with WWE Women's Champion Trish Stratus in their corner. Conspicuous by her absence was Carmella DeSether for the Diva Search girls. She no-showed this, which explains why this was a 6-on-6 dodgeball game and not 7-on-7. Now, this match, I can't really judge it as a match because it's not a match. It's just a dodgeball game. The famous thing about this match, if you want to call it that, I don't, but whatever. But the famous thing about this was that this was legit. The Raw Divas were brought to wrestler's court over losing this legit dodgeball game to the Diva Search girls. Ivory tells the story in a kayfabe commentary shoot that, you know, she was the Raw Divas defense attorney, Triple H was the judge. This whole thing was a ruse from the start in terms of wrestler's court. Just search it on YouTube if you want to hear the entire story of when the Raw Divas were brought to wrestler's court over losing a legit dodgeball game to the Diva Search girls. But this, I mean, what more can I say? It was a dodgeball game. It happened. The Diva Search girls defeated the Raw Divas in a minute 24 seconds. So, yeah, it was a dodgeball game. What more, really, what more can I say here? But the penultimate match of SummerSlam 2004, the second championship match of the night, for the WWE Championship, you had champion John Bradshaw Layfield versus challenger The Undertaker. JBL was in his first reign as WWE Champion, his only reign as WWE Champion, winning it at the Great American Bash back in June. And this was Undertaker's first world title match at a SummerSlam since SummerSlam 1998. On the July 22nd episode of SmackDown, after JBL defeated a random person, JBL bragged how he had no opponent for SummerSlam, nobody's worthy to wrestle him. Out comes The Undertaker, chokeslams JBL, and says, "You, me, SummerSlam." And then the bell rings. Toronto strikes again in this match. Is probably the most infamous match on the entire night because you have a WWE Championship match of JBL and The Undertaker. Especially with The Undertaker in this, you would think that the crowd would be a little more respectful because even in 2004, The Undertaker was the motherfucking Undertaker. But no. Holy shit, the Mexican Wave, chance of Spanish table. I mean, the crowd here didn't give one iota of a fuck about this match. I mean, nobody bought into JBL as the WWE champion. The build was just Undertaker saying, "You, me, SummerSlam," and that was about it. So you had no build. Nobody bought into JBL as champion. The match fucking sucked. So the fans pretty much showed their appreciation by shitting all over this match. And you know something is bad and means fuck all when The Undertaker, the motherfucking Undertaker, gets the Mexican Wave. You know something's bad. And the post-match spot almost got ruined when a fan almost hit the trap spot on JBL's limo. Just everything about this. When I call this the most infamous match of SummerSlam 2004, it is the most infamous match of SummerSlam 2004. Just everything from start to finish. Just holy crap. It's one of those bad matches that you should watch at least once just to see how bad it was. But John Bradshaw Layfield defeated The Undertaker by disqualification in 17 minutes, 37 seconds to retain the WWE Championship after the referee caught The Undertaker hitting JBL with the belt, causing the DQ. Post-match saw The Undertaker chokeslam JBL through the top of his limo. Seven matches down, eight if you count Sunday Night Heat, and nine if you count Divas Dodgeball. But all those matches down, it's now on to the main event of SummerSlam 2004, the third championship match of the night for the World Heavyweight Championship, champion Chris Benoit versus challenger Randy Orton. Benoit was in his first reign as World Heavyweight Champion, his only reign as World Heavyweight Champion in WWE, holding it since WrestleMania 20. And with a win here, Randy Orton would be the youngest world champion in WWE history. On the July 26th episode of Raw, Randy Orton won a 20-man Battle Royal to become number one contender for the World Heavyweight Championship at SummerSlam. Chris Benoit retained the World Heavyweight Championship against Triple H in an Iron Man match, and the match was set for SummerSlam, champion Chris Benoit, challenger Randy Orton. Now, this was the right spot for the main event, because Raw was the A show, the World Heavyweight Championship for a time was WWE's top title. Granted, this match didn't really have that much of a story to it, but Raw's top title, Raw the A show, it was the right spot for the main event, although I'm slightly shocked this went on last, because for the majority of Benoit's reign as World Heavyweight Champion, Benoit felt like a secondary world champion. Now, very little reaction for Orton at first, as per Canada tradition during shows after Montreal, you screwed Brett chance towards Earl Hebner. Now, despite all of that, despite some of the stuff from the crowd, this main event was amazing. One of the better main events in SummerSlam history, one of the better world title matches in SummerSlam history. As far as the big gold belt concerns at SummerSlam, it's up there amongst one of the better matches for the big gold belt in SummerSlam history. Unfortunately, this match and the moment afterwards, you can really never celebrate this match, this moment, ever again, for obvious reasons. But still a great match here, one of the better main events, really one of the only few good things on this show, period. Like this show was not that good, but Guerrero, Angle, and this match kind of saved this show for being like one of the bottom SummerSlams in history. Now, Orton, like I mentioned, at first, kind of no reaction. But Orton went from no reaction to getting a reaction. A positive reaction. Getting cheers. Especially after he escaped the crossface, reversed another crossface attempt into an RKO out of nowhere. A true RKO out of nowhere. One, two, three, and a pretty good babyface pop for someone associated with the company's top heel. Randy Orton defeated Chris Benoit in 20 minutes, 10 seconds to win the World Heavyweight Championship. And at 24 years and 4 months, Randy Orton became the youngest world champion in WWE history. But let's not be stupid here. We all know kind of the ulterior motives here. I think the majority of us can agree that the only reason Randy Orton won the World Heavyweight Championship here was to erase Brock Lesnar from the record book as youngest world champion in WWE history. Because as we know, Brock Lesnar left after WrestleMania 20. Brock was the youngest champion in company history. It's like, okay, Brock left in a shitty fashion. We'll show him. We'll show him. We're gonna make a new guy the youngest champion because fuck him. That's why. Randy Orton's young and, you know, the next big show, he's gonna be the youngest world champion. Why? Fuck it. Why not? Seriously, WWE can be so fucking petty when it comes to shit like this. Like when AJ Lee left, and because she was associated with CM Punk, Nikki Bella became the longest reigning Divas champion in history. Demolition sues the WWE, New Day becomes longest reigning tag champs in company history. And here in 2004, Brock Lesnar leaves, Randy Orton becomes the youngest world champion in company history. And the only reason that happened was because Brock left. Post-match, you saw Benoit tell Orton to be a man, shake his hand, which is exactly what Orton did. And this was really kind of the start of the Randy Orton babyface turn, but the less we talk about the 04-05 Randy Orton face run, the better. And holy crap, the main event was great. Kurt Angle, Eddie Guerrero was really damn good. Holy shit, though. SummerSlam 2004 was... Well, I don't really know how to describe this show. Was it a great show? Fuck no, it wasn't. It was far from a great show. But was it the drizzling shits? Not really. I mean, in the annals of SummerSlam history, the 2004 edition, it's in the bottom half of SummerSlam's all time, no doubt about it. But it's like you had Kurt Angle, Eddie Guerrero, Chris Benoit, Randy Orton. The rest of the show's fucking skippable, because outside of those two really good, and in the main event's case, a great match, the rest of the show is just, it's okay to what fucking ever. It's, the most memorable thing about this show is the crowd. And when the most memorable thing about a pay-per-view, especially a Big Four pay-per-view, is the crowd, you've got nothing. Again, Guerrero and Angle, Benoit Orton, everything else you can fucking skip. Was it the worst SummerSlam of all time? Absolutely not. At best, SummerSlam 2004 was a mediocre show. At worst, it was a bad show, but not complete shit. Only two matches are worth a damn. The rest you can just fucking skip. But now it's on to the Golden Ring Bell and the Brown Ring Bell for SummerSlam 2004. Golden Ring Bell for best match goes to Randy Orton versus Chris Benoit for the World Heavyweight Championship. Brown Ring Bell for worst match goes to Undertaker versus John Bradshaw Layfield for the WWE Championship. And before anybody says Divas Dodgeball, that wasn't an official match, so it can't be Brown Ring Bell. So, Golden Ring Bell, Orton Benoit, Brown Ring Bell, Undertaker, JBL. So there you have it. Share your thoughts on SummerSlam 2004 in the comments section below. Which babyfaces are getting booed at this year's SummerSlam? Share all those thoughts down in the comments section below. Now, since SummerSlam is so early this year, it's one of the earliest times that SummerSlam's ever taken place, but since SummerSlam's so damn early this year, I decided that with the remaining 3 weeks of August, I'll be talking about another August tradition in pro wrestling. The WCW August tradition. So, see you in Sturgis, because next time, the time after that, and the time after that, Hog Wild 1996, Road Wild 1997, and Road Wild 1998. Until next time, peace. Take us home, Alicia.
Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and hit that ding notification bell so anytime they post a brand new video, you'll get an alert and you can check it out. You guys, what are you waiting for? Go check it out. Check out their archive. Subscribe so you get all of those new videos. Dive in.